Bonjour. So hello everyone. I'm going to present to you our work on our study for scalability comparison for data management approach for smart metering systems. This work has been given or done by me and Christine Collet, and in collaboration with Enedis, which is the company for electricity or power distribution in France. So recent years have seen a huge investment towards smarter power grids, what we call a smart grid. This has been possible mainly because of advances in smart metering systems and techniques and sensors deployed massively over the or throughout the power grid. For instance, in France, there is a plan to deploy 35 million meters by ERDF or now Enedis by 2021. This will give insights into profile consumptions and client consumption, as well as the behavior of the power grid. On the other hand, it will generate a lot of data, more data that hardly know what to do with. So to speak about data in smart grids, we can distinguish two types of data, data in motion. These are data coming from a source to a destination, events, alarms, and alert signals. These are usually processed in event streaming paradigm, and which is out of the scope of this work. On the other hand, we are more interested in data at rest. These are collected meter data, sensors, client data, weather data, etc., in the whole ecosystem of the power grid. The difficulty here is at the scale of a smart grid, data can explode in size and in velocity and in variety as well, especially if we consider, for instance, at the scale of a smart grid as in US, in a region in US, as demonstrated by HP, they have like data for more than 40 plus million meters and a total of 22.5 trillion measurements. The question here is how to manage, store, manage, and process this data for business processes at the energy providers level. Especially if we consider that today we have a large cartography of large-scale data management solutions that exist today. So our goal in this study is to identify processing types on smart meter data to start with, and then compare large-scale data management and processing approaches or systems for each type of processing, as well as their scalability capacities or abilities. In order to do that, we are in need of data sets, illustrative data sets, illustrative queries, storage space, and the commodity hardware cluster infrastructure. So in the following, I will present the data processing in smart grid and their types. The data management and processing systems, the data generation process in our study, our experimental evaluation to conclude. So data come in masses from in smart grids, mainly from two sources, smart meters and sensors. These are temporal data with very important temporal dimension because it's mainly historical as well and current data. So after talking with experts from ERDF or Enedis, as well as looking in the literature for data management, meter data management systems, we could have identified three type of processing which are elementary almost in every business process in energy utilities. First, the aggregation queries based, for instance, on the sum of measurements in a region. The selection and filtering queries, which are based on, for instance, consumption filters. And most importantly, the bill computation queries, which are considered in meter data management system as the more complex, the very difficult queries that takes a lot of time to finish or to respond. This will lead us to talk about data management and processing systems that are most scalable today and very popular in the literature. So first we have the PostgreSQL, which is a relational database management system that is based on PostgreSQL, that have a master-slave architecture with massively parallel processing. It has a versioning-based concurrency control and asset semantics for OLTP workloads. As well, PostgreSQL actually adopts the range hashing partitioning of data. On the other side, we have Hadoop, the ecosystem based on MapReduce implementation that was presented in Google in 2003 with the MapReduce framework. We have the HDFS, the distributed file system for hosting data, and we have the Hive SQL query engine over MapReduce. We have also Spark as a representative for next generation MapReduce computation with in-memory processing and acyclic graph execution engine. And it's Spark SQL query engine over Spark. As a last system, we have Apache Cassandra. Cassandra was first developed at Facebook. It's combined the peer-to-peer architecture inspired by Amazon. What's the system of Amazon again? Dynamo, yes, Amazon Dynamo and Google Bigtable. Column family data model and memory management. It has a consistent hashing. It means that it partitions data based on the hash value of its keys to deploy over the infrastructure or the data nodes. And it has the SQL query language that was recently introduced, but this language, which is resembles to SQL, is very restrictive and doesn't provide, for instance, join operation and aggregation queries or functions. So to conduct our experimental evaluation, we would have loved to have real data. Unfortunately, at NEDs or ERDF, this was not possible for privacy reasons. We have to dig into the literature, and we found a work that was presented in EDBT 2015. They presented data generator for smart meter data. What they do actually is they have a small data set that was collected in Canada, and they generate new clients from this data set. They take profiles, they extract profiles by statistic means from they extract the profiles without the temperature characteristics. They combine then the profile extracted with a random weather data, weather data in order to provide new clients, which finally is generated by CSV in a CSV file. We followed this methodology in order to generate 1.7 terabytes for more than 5 million meters data over a year, with the measurement every hour and the total of more than 43 billion measurements. Unfortunately, we will be able to experiment only on 4 million for constraints about storage space and computation time in the grid. So now I'm going to present to you our experimental setup before moving to the experimental evaluation. So our experiments were conducted on Grid 5000. This is the cloud and grid testbed for scientific research in distributed computing in France, with 10 sites in France and Luxembourg. We conducted our experiments on the Nancy side. This is for a simple reason, because we have more nodes there and the service for storage that is available to host our data prior to experiments. We identified three sets of experiments, the increasing data size going from a little bit from 500,000 meters to 4 million, the scale out going or increasing the number of nodes horizontally from 70 to 140, and finally the last data set in order to contain all memory with the small data set in memory in order actually to give a fair comparison to Spark that will suffer suffer from memory issues in the other experiments. And this is because we have only 16 gigabytes of RAM per node in our infrastructure. So we had the Graphene and the Griffon clusters on the Nancy side. We used the Debian image that we deploy over the cluster based on Debian Wheezy Prod. We have these versions of the software we use, Postgres XL9.2, the distribution Cloudera CDH5 for Hadoop, and Spark 1.5, Apache Spark 2.2, and Spark Cassandra connector. So first, we started with data loading. We developed scripts actually to fetch data from storage 5K, which is based on NFS to load in every storage solution, which are Postgres XL, Cassandra, and HDFS. We can clearly see that Postgres XL is the solution that is slow to load data compared to HDFS and Cassandra. We could even observe that HDFS and Cassandra were even faster in charging data rather than fetching them from NFS in storage 5K based on NFS, actually. So now I will move to the experimental evaluation. To conduct our experiments, we identified a game of seven queries, three aggregation queries based on the sum usually, mainly, three selection and filtering queries based on consumption thresholds and time interval, as well as some sort additional clauses. And finally, the seventh query, which is based on the tarif vert of EDF, which is computes the bill mainly for its clients based on the prices that variates over different periods of time. So for the first the experimental set, which is increasing the data size going from 4 billion measurements to 35 billion measurements on 110 nodes, we could see clearly that PostgreSQL, the relational database system, is best suited for aggregation queries, and it outperforms all the other solutions. This is because it's based on an optimized query engine and the massively parallel processing architecture that actually favors the moving computation to nodes rather than data, which is very suited to aggregation computing and actually very good instinct to go with for big data processing. On the other hand, we see clearly that Spark suffers from a few issues here, both with Cassandra and with the HDFS. This is mainly because we don't have enough memory for initial data and intermediate data, and then Spark has to do swapping between disk and memory, and it becomes less efficient. On the other hand, it's the acyclic graph execution engine implementation of Spark and the programming model favors introducing a lot of intermediate phase, which introduces shuffle phases, which in turn introduce data transfers and performance delays. For the third query, when we filter in on time, Spark with Cassandra is performing much better because the filtering is done at the level of Cassandra rather than Spark, which is very fast because Cassandra can be optimized for time series. And it fetches data fastly from disk before giving a small data set that can be fit in memory to Spark to operate on. For the other queries, we could see that Spark with Cassandra is much better for the 6 and the 7 query, which we consider the most complex one. We could see that Spark, that Cassandra is very good for these queries where we look directly based on the hash value of some kind of values that we fetch directly. And this gives very small data set to be fit in memory for Spark, which in turn is processed like very, very fast. On the other hand, for the fourth query, we could see that the additional sort clause results in a small delay compared to PostgreSQL for the Spark with Cassandra solution. We could still see that Spark with HDFS is doing very badly compared even to Hadoop because of the memory issues in our setup. So now we move to the horizontal scalability experiments. Here, as mentioned before, we define two sets of experiments. The big sets, we move from, or we increase the cluster size from 17 nodes to 114 nodes with over 4 billion measurements in storage. And in the second set, which we call the small set, we use only 87 million measurements in order to have all the initial data fit in memory to see how Spark will react with that as well. So we could see that on the second and the third query that Spark actually for the big experiments scales well with additional memory in the cluster when increasing nodes, so it performs better when adding new nodes, but still does very badly compared to the other solution, mainly PostgreSQL, that continues to be the best solution for aggregation queries and Hadoop. On the other hand, when we move to the small experiments on this side, we could see that Spark with HDFS is doing much better than Hadoop now because it has available memory. But Spark with Cassandra is inefficient for this kind of range queries on the key of the meter ID filtering, which is not the big, very suited for Cassandra querying, and it results in very big delays for performance, mainly because the bottleneck is at the level of Cassandra. On the other hand, when we filter on the time for the third queries, when we move to the small experiments, we could see that Spark with Cassandra is doing much better, but still not very optimized to be at the level of Postgres Excel. On the other hand, for the same setups, so the experimental sets, the build query, which is considered, again, the most complex query for meter data management system, Cassandra continued to do brilliantly. We could see that Spark with Cassandra response in less than 1 second. No matter the size of the cluster, no matter the size of data, which is impressive compared to the other solution. That Spark with HDFS, when we move also to the small experiments with available memory, it starts to do much better, but still does not outperform Postgres Excel. I have here to mention that we have not been successful to deploy Postgres Excel on 140 nodes. This solution is relatively new compared to the others. It's not mature yet, and it has a lot of issues, mainly because sometimes you stumble upon errors that have no exceptions, no reasons, and just crashes without any reason. So let's hope that this will be fixed in the later versions. So now one of the most important results of our experiment is to see the data transfer in our experiments. So what we did, actually, we used a tool called VNStat in the cluster. This tool allowed us to measure the outgoing data transfer from every node from the cluster. And in this figure, we do the sum of all the figures, all the nodes in the cluster to have the total transfer in the cluster. We could see that Postgres Excel is the solution that moves less data because of its optimized query engine and massively parallel processing, and which is very good for lots of types of processing. On the other hand, Spark moves a lot of data, which is quite odd because in the era of big data processing, actually the instinct should be to reduce the data transfer, not the other way around. But because Spark actually is based on a lot of intermediate phases by choice, by design. Actually, when you write data Spark program, you are like doing flat map, map, reduce by key, other transformation, other actions. And every time there is an intermediate phase, a shuffle phase that transfers data around in non-optimized manner, which results in other delays. Still, you have in-memory processing and acyclic graph execution engine to enhance performance, but still, it's not enough. I here just mentioned that HDFS actually, at the data loading process, HDFS doesn't provide any data transfer because clients, when they contact HDFS, the metadata server will direct them directly to the data nodes that will host data, and the data will direct there to be stored immediately without additional transfer in the cluster, so it produces less data transfer in the cluster. So here, actually, if we remove the data loading part, Postgres Excel is actually moving a lot of less data than Hadoop. Just to mention that. So to conclude, we presented an experimental evaluation of four systems, which are Postgres Excel, Hadoop, Spark with Cassandra, for meter data processing case. We could conclude there is no best fit approach for all, as we know since long years, but we conclude also that Postgres Excel is best suited for aggregation queries, that we could learn a lot of lessons from the relational, parallel relational databases, implementations and design concepts in order to, transfer them or their knowledge to the big data processing platforms. That Spark for Cassandra, for instance, is very suited for lots of selection and filtering queries and could enhance a lot of performance. And the data loading is very fast for Cassandra and HDFS as well compared to relational database systems. So I think also maybe one of the lessons here is maybe we should think to move forward towards federated and multi-store systems. Actually, I was pleased to see that here in BDAI yesterday, for instance, there were two demonstrations about such systems, and today there was a presentation in this session. And to work more towards how to federate, more to think about federation and metadata management in such complex setups. I have to mention also there is a lot of problems for big data experimentation on the grid 5000, which is very popular here in France for academic research. For us people coming from the database and big data community, I think we should be allowed more suitable charts, utilization charts, in order to be able to conduct more thorough big data experiments. Thank you for listening.
Okay, nous avons un peu de temps pour quelques questions.
Okay, so sometimes with the we see an increase of the data transfer with the number of nodes. Sometimes we see a decrease. Is there an explanation for that? Is there
That's one of the things we couldn't explain. It has to do with the internals of Spark, actually. Sometimes, I mean, moving from the infrastructure. Well, from 20 to 30 nodes, there is a slight change of the infrastructure because at some point we were only on one cluster. We moved to two clusters in the NoSQL site, but it doesn't explain it all, actually. This has to do with the internals of Sparks, and we had no means to profile that to understand exactly why it's behaving like that. But it's consistent with both implementation of Spark, with the Spark HDFS and the Cassandra.
Okay, thank you.
Cool. Okay, d'autres questions?
Je me permets de poser la question en français, tu peux répondre.
Bah oui, il n'y a pas de souci.
Est-ce que vous avez essayé de tester le passage à l'échelle, mais vertical? Dans l'impact de la mémoire, en plus du...
Bah oui, mais le problème, c'est l'infrastructure. Bien évidemment, j'aurais aimé faire ça. Seulement dans la grille 5000, ça c'est les machines les plus gourmandes que j'ai pu trouver avec 16 gigas de mémoire. J'aurais aimé tester sur 200 gigas de mémoire, c'est certes, mais malheureusement on n'a pas l'infrastructure nécessaire pour faire ça.
D'accord, merci.
Peut-être que ça va changer dans le futur.
Peut-être une dernière question. D'accord. Une dernière question.
Bah, écoutez, merci.
Merci.
Merci de votre présence.
Est-ce que tu peux signer aussi?
Ouais.